EPDP for inviting all of us here, of course, including myself. Allow me to introduce myself. I'm Professor Reside from Renato Reside from the UP School of Economics. So I teach at the school, and so many of the people who will be presenting papers here are my friends. There will be three papers to be presented here in this parallel session A3. The first to present is Professor Ruperto Alonso of University of the Philippines School of Economics. He will present a paper entitled Assessment of the Philippine Power Sector Policy Landscape. And then the second paper will be presented by someone who is not new to the Philippines, but just arrived yesterday. His name is Professor Bulet Akma from Anadolu University in Turkey. His paper is entitled Turkish Energy Politics and Economics, Becoming an Energy Hub in the Future. And then last but not least, two of my colleagues will also present. Dr. Adarashon Navarro of Philippine Institute for Development Studies, or PIDS, and also Dr. Larnie Escresa from UP School of Economics will present their paper on the economics and politics of power plant approvals in the Philippines. So before I give the floor to the presenters, let me remind the presenters that each one of you have 20 minutes to present, and then there will be a little time, let's say maybe about 10 minutes for question and answer, for open discussion. And then questions will be entertained only after all presentations have been given. So for participants, or the people who are going to listen, you have pens and papers that are available with you, so you can jot down your questions while the presentations are going on. All right, so let me start with the first presenter. The first presenter is Professor Ruperto Alonso. He is a colleague of mine from the University of the Philippines School of Economics, and also he's also from EPDP. And he's been with the faculty for a long time now, but nevertheless, he's still a breath of fresh air every time I see him. All right, so without further ado, I give the floor to Professor Alonso.
Thank you, Renato, and good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Let me remind people that there are two other parallel sessions going on, no? Over on the fourth floor, because some of you may just be staying here because of the inertia of after that sumptuous lunch. No? This paper is actually co-authored with two other people, not Attorney Tim Guanson and Peter Paul Taton. And let me remind people too that this is still work in progress. As a matter of fact, the way I see it is that in the final version, the paper will be drawing a lot from the other presentations that will be given, that have been given and will be given in this conference here. So it's an assessment of the Philippine power sector policy landscape. Let me begin with... Where do I point this to? Ayaw pa rin eh. Okay, so by way of background, in the late 1980s to early 1990s, we find the Ministry of Energy during the time President Marcos downgraded to President Aquino's Office of Energy Affairs. During the Marcos regime, under the dictatorship, decision-making was fast. The Ministry of Energy was one of the most powerful agencies then. It had two well-funded subsidiary corporations, the National Power Corporation for Electricity and the Philippine National Oil Commission Corporation for the management of our oil needs, particularly oil importation. PNOC is still surviving, while NPC, part of it is still around, the NPC, the SPUG, the NPC SPUG, the NPC Special Power Utilities Group. The downside of that Marcos period was that there was a tendency to cut corners. For example, the ECC process was bypassed, that's the environmental compliance certificate process was bypassed at the time. So it was already a requirement. Major projects did not go through such environmental clearance process. And we do find many players in the power sector now complaining about the long period it takes to have an environmental clearance certificate approved. There were also allegations of graft and corruption due to the lack of transparency. For example, oil purchases from the Middle East and the decisions of the nuclear power plant were often questioned with respect to the graft and corruption issues surrounding them. The nuclear power plant started from a cost of $650 million, which moved up to $1.1 billion and then eventually to $2.2 billion, and still we do not see it operating. The 6% drop in GDP during this period was an estimate coming from the Asian Development Bank. So the Aquino government decided to mothball the 621 megawatt nuclear power plant. After the Chernobyl catastrophe in April 1986. And this led to a severe power crisis because of slow decision making on the construction of new power plants. In the early 1990s to the year 2000, under the Ramos regime, we find the Department of Energy being resurrected. The emergency powers were given to President Ramos, and many take or pay power purchase agreements were signed. But the problem then was the high cost of those IPP contracts. And the I don't know if it's a consensus, but many students of the industry believe that part of the reason for the high power costs that we find now is because of the excess capacity that was brought about with the expansion of power generation plants in response to the power crisis before. Indeed, by the end of 1995, the total installed capacity was 189% of peak demand. So that practically not solved the energy crisis, but at the same time, there appeared to be excess supply, an excess expansion of capacity at that period. Napocor also experienced heavy losses, and the high cost of power from the PPAs and those IPPs could not be passed on fully to the consumers as automatic price adjustment, as the automatic price adjustment mechanism covered only fuel cost and exchange rate movements. It was not until 1997 that the fuel and purchase power cost adjustment was implemented. So this is the graph that I saw from a paper of the previous Energy Secretary, Secretary Perez, that shows that projections that were done, the blue line here, is the demand projection done in 1993 by the National Power Corporation as incorporated in the Power Development Plan of 1993. The red line was an update in 1996 of the demand projections, which we see to be adjusted downwards already. But when we look at actual consumption and electricity consumption given by the green line, then we do see how far, how much excess capacity came about in response to the, as over response to the power crisis of the late 1980s. So, by the year 2001, the Electric Power Industry Reform Act was passed. The main features are the unbundling of the electricity sector into separate generation, transmission, distribution, and retail supply entities, the deregulation of the generation sector, the privatization of government's power generation assets, the creation of the wholesale electricity spot market, retail competition and open access, although we still have not realized that fully. It was supposed to have been rolled out fully by 2007, and then the schedule got moved to 2011, and up to now, we still are waiting for the full rollout of this, what we refer to as ARCOA, the retail competition and open access. The EPIRA also put up the Energy Regulatory Commission as the main regulator in one of the presentations this morning by Joy Abrenica. We saw a comparison of how the ERC's powers and responsibilities line up with that of the newly set up or newly installed Competition Commission. And so it remains to be seen how the two regulatory bodies will be working with each other. So 14 years after EPIRA, we have seen tables like this in the presentation of Wally Del Mundo this morning. We see the Philippines still having the highest tariffs compared to neighboring countries in the ASEAN. Even in terms of other indicators like the percent of the population using biomass for cooking, we still see the Philippines having such a high rate for its level of per capita income compared to other ASEAN countries. In terms of quality of electricity supply, these are data from the World Economic Forum, where tabulating responses to the question, how would you assess the quality of the electricity supply in your country in terms of lack of interruptions and lack of voltage fluctuations? Again, we see the Philippines ranking low. Well, in terms of scores, we find that what countries, well, Malaysia certainly outstrips us. Thailand also does. That was in 2007-2008, during lately we have had some improvements, but not really much. We're just, by 2014, we're just back to the 2007 level. But has the price situation, relative price situation, really deteriorated after EPDP? Now, this is a comparison of the residential tariffs among the ASEAN five, the big ASEAN countries, comparing 1996 to the year 2011, where we indexed it to the Philippines at 1.0, we find that indeed we are higher than, well, we were higher than all other countries in 1996, and still higher in by the year 2011. But in terms of relative price differences, we have had some improvements relative to two countries and deterioration relative to the two other countries within ASEAN. Oops, what happened here? Sorry. So, together with the EPDP, we also find the Renewable Energy Act of 2008. In this Renewable Energy Act, we find the objectives in terms of accelerated development of renewable energy resources, encouragement of the use of RE to prevent or reduce harmful emissions and protect the environment. The main instrument for implementing this is the feed-in tariff system, which we saw in the discussion this morning by Jim Rumaset. The main, among the main features of this feed-in tariff system is a take-or-pay arrangement over 20 years at fit rates. In other words, if we sign a contract now, that the price we commit to is good for 20 years, subject to a slow degradation of those prices, as we see in this table. The for several RE sources, we find that there would be a lowering of tariffs by 0.5% per year or after every 2 years for certain types of renewable energy resource. But another complaint here is that we saw discussed this morning slightly is that for solar, there was an increase in the installation target from 50 megawatts in 2011 to 500 megawatts for 2015. And also for wind from 200 megawatts to a high 400 megawatts. So what we try to do in this assessment is to examine the fit between the goals and the policy instruments and identify the substantive and administrative policy gaps and needs. So we ask what are the goals and objectives of EPDP and the RE law. And what are the plans and programs of policies appropriate to achieve economic efficiency and so on. Now again, let me point out that that we address these research questions through secondary studies. Now, we're not doing our own, say, primary data collection. We're compiling what could be learned from research by other people here in EPDP, as well as other sources that study the area. And as we see here from the secondary sources of data, we have government studies, those of development partners, civil society groups. We also engage in dialogue with government officials and with stakeholders from the different sectors. Generation, transmission, distribution, We conducted a policy forum last August 2015, where we brought together different players from these different stakeholders. So we follow the summary of the two basic laws, the EPIRA and the Renewable Energy Act, as embodied in the energy reform agenda, which is still the basis for being used by the Department of Energy in its planning, activities. For this is a key plan for energy security, we saw an extensive discussion this morning from the paper of Vale del Mundo, looking at long-term energy security and with actual measures, and we're going to adapt that into our paper, cite them that as source, as well as short-term energy security. This demand outlook, we saw again this morning a different, an updated set of projections by Mr. Del Mundo, that we hope to compare with the actual projections of the DOE in its most recent power development plan. On fossil fuel dependence, again, this was discussed this morning, that we hear complaints that the majority of committed projects are coal-fired plants, but the RE law mandates that, department circular from the DOE mandates that we should be maintaining at least 30% renewable energy share in total power generation capacity. The challenges in attracting new capacity, this listing of such challenges comes from different sources, among them the foreign chambers of commerce of the Philippines, such as a lack of clear and stable energy policy, the approval and construction bottlenecks. Again, we shall see this in the paper, in the third paper for this session, an expanded discussion of of such bottlenecks in construction. And the aggregation issue was also discussed this morning in the paper of Raul Fabella and Wally Del Mundo. The limitations of the transmission grid, this listing comes from government sources, the Department of Energy in particular, giving problems in the Luzon grid, as well as the possible solutions to such limitations. The Visayas grid, again, was discussed this morning by Raul Fabella and also by Jim Rumaset. The Mindanao grid remains a problem. It is hoped that the interconnection of Zamboanga to Negros would allow the projected excess power in Mindanao to be sold in the Luzon Visayas grid. So, other challenges faced by the National Grid Corporation include that shallow connection charging policy, where the generator pays only for the equipment to connect to the grid and not for reinforcement of the grid. There are also differences in incentives between the National Grid Corporation and the generators, where generators choose sites that minimize production costs, disregarding distance to the grid. And National Grid Corporation, we often find complaining that that they were not consulted in the location of those power plants. So those timing coordination issues we also find. So these are the other issues that we hope to address in the final version of the paper. The optimal energy pricing, and the sustainable energy plan. So again, let me repeat that this is a work in progress. We do hope that that we benefit from this conference towards the fuller discussion of an assessment of the issues, policy issues confronting the power sector. So let me end my presentation here. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Alonso. Our next presenter is got his PhD from Istanbul University, and he's currently a researcher and lecturer at the Department of Economics at Anadolu University, as well as head of Southeastern Anatolia Project in Turkey. So he's basically done a lot of work with his government and other private institutions in his country, Turkey. So please welcome Dr. Bulent Akba from Anadolu University in Turkey.
Thank you very much for President. I would like to give some information about myself. I am a professor of economics at Anadolu University of Turkey in Central Anatolia. As you know, it's very far from here, Turkey. Also, my university, one of the biggest universities in the world. We have more than 2 million students, one of the challengeable universities in the world. Then, I would like to talk about today some of the issues about Turkey becoming an energy hub in the near future. Then this study still draft. This is today I would like to talk about some part of my study because it's not complete yet. Then if any remarks, any the discussion, it can be very helpful for me. First of all, this issue is very important nowadays because especially oil and natural gas will be becoming more important issue, especially in our region, in the Middle East, Asia and Russia and other countries. First of all, let me including which topic in this presentation. First of all, Turkey position. Where is the Turkey? I mean, as an energy hub. Second one, any link between Turkey energy strategy of joining the European Union. As you know, Turkey is still candidate countries for joining the European Union since 20 years, maybe more. Also, Turkey can become an energy hub in the near future, and conflicting pipelines and domestic terrorism, especially challenge a road ahead. As you know, recently there is a many hot conflict in our region, especially the Middle East region, including Syria, Iraq, Iran, and Russia. And lastly, conclusion and some remarks. Turkey position, as you know, Turkey favorably geostrategic location as the bridge to Europe, Central Asia, and Caspian Sea. Turkey's transit country to energy-hungry European Union from Middle East, the Caspian Sea, and Central Asia, and Russia, because it's located between hydrocarbon consumers and suppliers, and owing to strategic geographical location, Turkey is a very important player in the energy security in the Europe. As you see, this is a general map of Turkey. You can see many neighbors from Syria, Iraq, Iran, Armenia, Georgia, and some of the European countries. As you know, Turkey is located in ASEAN Europe and also some part of the Europe, and mostly in Anatolia, in Asia side. As you see, Turkey has a, just like the between a firing, between firing with the very neighbors, very dangerous neighbors like Syria, Iraq, Iran, and others. Then, thank you. Sometimes location can be advantage, but sometimes can be disadvantage, you know. First of all, there is a big challenge, especially some pipeline for Turkey. First one, Baku-Tbilisi-Ceyhan pipeline, the main component of the West, S-West energy corridor, is the Baku-Tbilisi-Ceyhan pipeline. It has been operating since 2006 and has the capacity more than 1 billion barrels per day and more than 1,760 kilometers in a second, longest of its kind of the world pipeline. A second component of the East-West Energy Corridor is South Caucasian Natural Gas Pipeline. Since 2007, this has been operation, and transport gas from the Shah Deniz field of Caspian Sea in Azerbaijan through Georgia to Turkey. Also, I don't know how can see, but this is not clear. There is some pipeline you can see from the Azerbaijan, from Iraq, Iran, and other countries, also connecting with some European countries in the near future. These are existing some potential pipelines for the near future, especially for suppliers to European countries. Second one of the biggest pipeline project, Nabucco project. 2009 agreement was signed in Ankara between Turkey, Bulgaria, Hungary, Romania, and Austria. According to this agreement, natural gas had to be transported through the planned Nabucco pipeline. It was a major step towards the decreasing the EU dependence of the energy on Russia. The pipeline was supposed to carry Azeri, Turkmen, Iraq, and Egyptian gas to Europe via Turkey. This is also a very important project. And it's the location of the Nabucco pipeline, as you see, from Baku, Tbilisi, and through to Turkey, and after that, it's going to some European countries. I think it could be more, especially Austria, is the last point for this pipeline. And another project is very important also, TANAP project. This is a trans-Adriatic pipeline project. This is also very important, especially carry from Azerbaijan gas to all some of the European countries. Officially opening the southeastern gas corridor to the EU states. The pipeline with estimated cost of the $7 billion will transport 16 BCM gas annually from Azerbaijan through to Georgia to Turkey. And after that, this project will be supplied to some of the European countries in the near future. Also, this is the Trans-Anatolian Gas Pipelines, TANAP project. As you see, it's again from Azerbaijan through to Georgia, via Turkey and some of the European countries. This is a rota of pipeline. Our question is any link between Turkey energy strategy and its goal of joining European Union. As you know, Turkey is a democratic country founded as a republic 1923, and Turkey became an associate member of the EU and it's conducted political and economic reforms for becoming a full member of the European Union since 2000. This process of Europeanization has had a big, great impact of the Turkey foreign policy. As regards Turkey ambitions of becoming an energy hub between Asia, Middle East and Europe doesn't represent a shift eastward. Instead, it wants to provide energy security and diversification of energy to the EU in order to strengthen its negotiation chips towards becoming an EU member. According to Turkey energy strategy, Turkey believes that the opening the energy chapter will surely pave the way of the negotiation with the EU and Turkey membership of energy community. A second question, can Turkey become an energy hub, internal and external challenge? And mostly journalists and some scientists thinking positively about the possibility of Turkey becoming an energy gateway. There are some challenges. One of the competition between different pipelines supported by Turkey, political instabilities in the region and internal instability and problems. These obstacles together with the other geopolitical dynamics and the strategic calculation of the regional actors can improve this process. As you know, we have some problem to be energy hub in our region, especially our region and some of the domestic challenges are not stable. As you know, as I mentioned before, we have a very dangerous, unstable countries like Syria, Iraq, and Iran. Also recently, as you know, we have some new problem with the Russia. Russian warplane downed by the Turkish army last November, and Turkey has some problem with our neighbors, especially supplier from Russia, Iraq, Iran, and others. Another external challenge in the Caucasian and the Middle East, the other powerful actors also have an interest in this region, especially Russia and Iran. Russia has political leverage on Kazakhstan and Turkmenistan, because it's a tries to buy energy for these states in order to prevent the Caspian gas to transport it to Europe. Russia accept that Turkey could be a big challengeable in the near future, is a big candidate in the special connect with the European countries in the near future, then it can be a problem, especially with Russia. Also, some of the conflict and some of the terrorism in our region. As you know, Turkey's geographic location gives the privilege to provide Europe energy security, although it does have energy resources its own, but Turkey could be a good supplier for energy security for some of the European countries. And Turkey also aims to become the energy hub in this region. The reason behind of this energy strategy are multi-dimensional. Turkey energy strategy can be some serious problem, not only internally, but also externally, because Turkey energy strategy is not consistent as it supports rival pipelines and domestic energy demand is increasing. Moreover, the political problem with the PKK and the Cyprus issue also challenges the energy strategy with the European Union. Externally, Turkey supports the pipelines which is come from the politically instable regions, namely Caspian and Middle East. There is a still continue some of the ethnic conflicts and political unrest position in this region. Also, Turkey has a big problem in the near future for some of the Caspian countries, as well as the Russia and Iraq, Iran, because they are still would like to strong player in this market, especially oil and natural gas market. Then there is a big challengeable, not only Turkey, but also the other countries, which I mentioned before. In the near future, we believe that if Turkey joining the European Union, and also Turkey could be a big and important player in our region for energy security, between link the Asia to Europe, as well as the Middle East and the Russia, then Turkey has a more dynamic situation, because Turkey is a growing economy and very challengeable source, especially in Turkey. And Turkey also still continue negotiation with the European Union for joining the European Union as a member and in the near future. Also, Turkey, some advantage about in this region, because there is a big potential for natural gas and oil, and in the near future, Turkey could be a important player in this region. Then both supplier and the big consumer in the near future. Then I would like to talk about this briefly, my presentation. As I mentioned before, this is a draft version of my last study. If any question, if any remarks are welcome. Thank you very much for listening to me.
Thank you very much, Dr. Bulet Akma. Okay, we have another presentation by two colleagues of mine. They will be following one another in sequence. No? They will present a paper entitled "The Economics and Politics of Power Plant Approvals in the Philippines." Our first presenter earned her PhD in economics from the UP School of Economics and is a senior research fellow at the Philippine Institute for Development Studies, or PIDS. And she does a lot of work on infrastructure. And then the second presenter who will follow her is from the UP School of Economics. She is Professor Larni Escresa. Got her graduate degrees in Europe, and she has now come home to teach in this country. All right, so can you please take the floor, Adora? Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Reside. Good afternoon, everyone. So I'm here to present the initial findings of our study on the economics and politics of power plant project approvals in the Philippines. We've actually reached the inception report only, but we've managed to gather important key findings, and I think that's why the EPDP organizers asked us to present this afternoon. Okay, So this is a joint project, and I'll talk about the background, research questions and objectives, and analytical framework, and then I'll turn you over to my co-researcher, Dr. Escoresa, for the more exciting preliminary results and the next steps. Okay, so why are we motivated to do the study? We're very much aware, the local researchers here and the local policymakers and investors are very much aware that we have a series of problem of long delays in the permitting process for power plant projects. And examples include the 600 megawatt power plant in Subic, which was vigorously opposed by the local community, and the Court of Appeals revoked the environmental clearance for this project in 2013. Recently, the Supreme Court overturned the Court of Appeals ruling, so that's a positive development. Another example is the coal-fired power plant, proposed power plant in Nara, Palawan. That's only 15 megawatts, but it was opposed by the municipal office because it's going to be located in a protected area for marine life. And the adjoining municipality was selected as an alternative location. But that municipality doesn't want a coal power plant in their backyard either. So there's no decision yet in this case. And there many other examples that I'm sure local stakeholders can come up with. So the consensus, the emerging consensus, is that it's a very, very long process for securing permits. And one generating company claimed that we need 160 plus clearances, and the entire process can stretch to 5 years. Actually, I tried to count the number of permits, and I reached 80 plus, but that doesn't include yet the different locational clearances from different local government units. So if a project covers many municipalities, you need to get, say if it's 15, get clearances from 15 mayors. And if there are also barangay clearances that need to be secured, so you need to get from each, you need to talk with each barangay level community. So it's really a very lengthy process. So there's this misperception. We put a question mark there because we're still trying to validate whether that perception is actually true. There's a we think right now that it's yet to be validated that there is an impasse at the local level. Because there are locations wherein LGUs are very cooperative. For example, Bataan, local governments there are more cooperative in hosting power plants. In the case of the 600 megawatt project in Subic, which I mentioned earlier, the impasse was due to the opposition of a government corporation, not really the local government. Okay, so what do we want to do? So we want to analyze the incentives of the different agencies giving out permits, and we want to see how such incentives can be misaligned or mismatched. We've looked at the literature, and we've seen some which developed a criteria by which to evaluate the different permits and licenses by looking at the purposes and by looking at whether the purposes are served and whether these are done in an efficient manner. So we want to do the same process, development of a criteria for evaluating permits. We're doing that now. We're assessing the current approval procedures, and we're looking at the efficiency of the processes and whether, in the end, consumer welfare is upheld. So let's revisit what the economics of regulation literature says about regulating electricity generation. There is high capital intensity. The assets that you need to invest in are long-lived, and there are economies of scale and scope, and the assets are highly specific. you cannot, after investing in a certain technology, you cannot use the assets that you've built for other purposes. So it's highly specific for power generation. And there can be negative externalities involved, and this affect different voting jurisdictions differently. That's why we need to look at the possible politicization of our regulatory decisions. And in this study, we distinguish between the impact of regulatory governance and content. So we're focusing not on the content, not on prices, not on quantity, but on the regulatory structure that permits the institutions. And the methodological goal is to develop a set of criteria for appraising the regulatory governance in the Philippine power generation sector. So we're now gathering descriptions of the number of permits, looking at the critical path in the whole process, or the critical paths, and looking at sources of bottlenecks based on key informant interviews with GenCos. We've managed to interview some GenCos, and we'll continue this, and we will also interview regulators and the Department of Energy, of course. So we'll classify, and we're doing that now, we're classifying the different licenses and permits based on technology. For example, in renewable energy technology, you need additional permits related to feed-in tariff application. And you don't need that for fossil fuel fired power plants. We're looking also at de jure and de facto purposes of the permits. And that means we're comparing what's stated in the law, de jure, and what's actually happening in practice, de facto. And we want to look at the respective accountability of the different agencies. In some of our conversations with stakeholders, they're saying that, why does it take for the ERC a very long time to process applications, review permits? Aren't they supposed to be accountable with respect to, you know, the procedures or the provisions of the Anti-Red Tape Act of 2007. Well, I revisited it last night and learned that the Energy Regulatory Commission is actually, since it's a quasi-judicial entity, it's actually exempted from, you know, following the strict requirements of the Anti-Red Tape Act. And somebody from the energy bureaucracy is nodding his head. And I think that's one problem that we need to resolve. Okay, so for the more exciting preliminary results, I give you to Dr. Escoresa.
So I would like to emphasize that our results are very preliminary since we started quite recently. So just to give you an idea of the statistics, right? So this is just the generation mix. I think that this was also already shown earlier. And you can see that the generation mix per region, Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao. So Luzon relies heavily on coal, Visayas relies heavily on geothermal, and Mindanao relies heavily on hydropower. Now, but the thing that we would like to emphasize, and is one that is more closely related to our study, is that most of the GenCos, the generation power plants, the power plants, are quite old, right? So out of the 104 power plants, 44 have been existing for more than 20 years. And most of them were built from 1995 to 2005 by independent power producers. And here we have the table showing the age of the power plants by number. So most of them, oops, sorry. So how do you turn the pointer here? So most, okay, it doesn't work. So the pointer is not working, I'm sorry. So most of the GenCos are old, over 20 to 30 years old. And here we have the in megawatts. The previous slide is by number of power plants, and this one is based on megawatts. Right. Okay. So we would like to look at the, as we mentioned earlier, our study is, the objective of our study is to look at the regulatory governance, the non-price regulation aspect. So, and we focus specifically on the permitting process. And we can see that the different permits, so 160 permits, they all have different objectives. There's a reason why they are there. So one of them is economic and regulatory. And this set of permits are there because to serve economic regulation, provision of economic incentives arising from the particular characteristics of electric power generation as an industry. And these characteristics have been emphasized by Professors Wolak and Professor Fabelia, and these are the power supply agreement, which is handed by the Energy Regulatory Commission, the investment incentives from the Department of Trade and Industry, and the feed-in tariff rate for the applicable renewable energy. Now, the other set of permits, we refer to them as the social permits, because as you can see, everyone, the net benefits from power generation may be positive, right? Everybody would benefit from lower price of electricity, but certain externalities, certain social costs at the generation stage may be local. So you have this particular asymmetry, and this is addressed by certain permits that you have to get from the barangay clearance, local government units, and in some cases, these are generation plants, power plants, may be very location specific and may be within the domain of indigenous people's domain, right, lands. So you need to get a permit from the National Commission on Indigenous People, the free and prior informed consent from NCIP. And the other set of permits refers to the optimization, the need to optimize the use of natural resources and to regulate the quality of the environment across time between the present and its future uses. And these are the environmental compliance certificate from the DENR, Department of Environment and Natural Resources, and the water permits issued by the National Water Regulatory Board. And then there are other technical and other regulations that are specific to electricity, right? These are the set of permits related to the specific and technical characteristics of electricity as a good. These are very complicated engineering permits. And an example of this is the grid impact study issued by the National Grid Corporation of the Philippines, as well as the feasibility study or also the pre-feasibility studies reviewed by the Department of Energy. Now, when we look at this separately, these permits have a particular objective, social objective in mind, economic and social objective in mind that may be benevolent. Now, the problem here is that when taken as a whole, especially if this permits, the rules in obtaining this permits lack transparency, they are not clear, and they are not consistent, then what happens is that when taken as a whole, you may have the unintended consequence of providing more room for rent-seeking behavior and opportunistic behavior. Now, this is the problem. So we have to separate the de facto, the claim, from what is actually happening, the de jure. Now, the other, so what is the other unintended consequence based on our key interviews is that it has actually, the long permitting process, the other unintended objective is that it acts as a barrier to entry. Okay, it acts as a barrier to entry, and it also deviates from the optimal energy mix, right? Because some of the permits, the number of permits also vary based on location and also technology, right? And then the other is that it also increases the regulatory risk. Now we can also divide this, look at it based on the steps, right? So you have the registration stage, the permits needed in complying with the securities and other economic regulation, the pre-development stage, which includes but is not limited to the feasibility study. So these are locational permits mostly, the free and prior informed consent from NCIP, etc. And the development stage is when you have the actual construction of the plant that when it commences, right, operation after achieving financial closure. These are the power supply agreement with ERC and FIT. Now, based on our initial results, so understand again that we are trying to relate regulatory governance with the performance, the number of investments in the generation sector, right? So what we did was that, okay, the first thing that we have to do is to make our hands dirty, go there, and try to understand the detailed steps, looking at the case of a hydropower plant, right? So here we have it, the registration stage. Now, I would like to emphasize that the construction of this process flow is not so trivial as it may seem, because it requires effort, because even to industry participants, this is quite difficult to map, right? And so based on our results, one of the bottlenecks here lies with the in the registration stage is the barangay clearances, and here is where and the different permits from the LGUs, and this is when the regulatory governance interacts with the particular political and social institutional endowment of a particular country. So the electoral cycle, for example, may affect the locational clearances from barangay and the different LGUs. Now here, the bottlenecks that were identified is, again, I emphasize that this is quite preliminary, is the grid impact study from the NGCP, the water permits from the National Water and Regulatory Board, and the land conversion permits from DAR, another probably that we have to mention here is that the environmental compliance certificate from DNR has a particular time frame, in that if that particular time frame lapses, then it is considered to be approved. So this might be an institutional innovation that we have to keep in mind, that is available if you want to facilitate the permitting process. And then here at this stage is some bottlenecks in the power supply agreement from the ERC. Right. So, and as a result from this, we can, as the relationship between this and the growth in the generation capacity, we can already establish a link that aside from the price regulation, then regulatory governance, the quality of regulatory governance, as seen from the permitting process, has an impact in the generation sector. Okay, so I think that this wraps up our presentation, and the next steps is that we have to still a lot of things to do. So we have to evaluate criteria, develop certain criteria to evaluate the regulatory capacity, conduct more KII's roundtable discussion. Okay, and then we also have some emerging recommendations that we can identify at this particular stage. So I think I'm running out of time, so maybe I'd give the floor to some question and answer.
Okay, may I call the presenters up to the stage to make yourselves available for question and answer. All right, so we have a little bit of time, maybe 10 minutes for question and answer. And if you have any questions, kindly state, well, you can go up to the microphone as usual and then state your name and affiliation, and then you may ask your question. Thank you. All right, there's a question from the gentleman here on my right. Please also state the one you are going, the presenter you address your question to.
Yes, my name is Volker Steigerwald. I'm from German International Cooperation. And this question goes to Professor Alonso with regard to power policy. I was wondering, Professor Alonso, that you were mentioning the fit, of course, as an important policy issue, but you were not mentioning net metering, and I would like to know why.
Well, net metering is relatively new. No? In fact, our experience is still very, very, very short at this point. But thank you for pointing that out. No? We shall be including that in our update on the paper. Thank you.
All right. Any more? Okay. Any more? All right. Is there a question? Okay, from on my left, yes. From Congress.
First, congratulations to the groups that's studying the process flow for permits. That's very good, the inventory, the process flow, and everything. I like it.
Yeah, kindly introduce
yourself. Yeah, going there. Now, we actually counted, if you look at the DOE website, they have an investor process flow. We counted it, 42 offices, make it 37, 112 signatures. Now, one thing that you could consider is, Professor Alonso actually said it, projects of national significance, declaring the projects of national significance. Second, but one comment is, sometimes the investors know that it's a protected area. In the first place, why build it there? You know it's already a protected area. Wag mo nang magkakagulo, di ba? So, wag na magbagaan kasi alam mo na, like a cement plant in Bulinaw, you have the UP Marine there. Why build a cement plant there? So, yung mga ganun tipo, ano. Another thing is, one of my senior colleagues was actually proposing a PESA-type tax regime because nakikialam usually ang LGUs for the benefits. If you come up with a PESA-type tax regime for investors, covered na yung LGUs doon. May benefits na sila. If you apply the gross 5%, for example, to the gross income, and distribute according to the type of LGU, makikinabang ang ano. That's a proposal from a senior colleague, the Director General of the Congressional Policy. I think you could consider that. But congratulations.
Thank you for your proposals. Actually, the points you raised are already being considered, and it's in the inception report, like the proposal to declare power projects as something that is of national significance, and the proposals on LGU benefits, and the one point that you raised is on taxation. These are already being considered. Now, on your point about going in locations which are declared as protected areas already, that's the choice of the generating companies. You know? And there are cases wherein they can prove that although a protected area is in the vicinity, there are mitigating measures for perceived environmental impacts. So there are cases like those. And well, it's really a balancing of efficiency considerations and also externalities which can be mitigated. But of course, GenCos should be very much aware that if you locate in areas which are declared as, say, ancestral domains or marine protected areas, then naturally you will encounter opposition.
All right. Any further questions? Yeah, I think there's one more. Yes.
Hi, Peter Turingan from the Senate Economic Planning Office. Related to question ni Mac on the permitting process. I guess you were being rushed already. That's why you weren't able to linger on the slides. We couldn't absorb all of the yung flow chart of ano. I was wondering which of those steps was yung pinakamatagal. I couldn't read it also because maliit yung ano. I thought I saw a box there that was 300 days. If you could, which are the steps na kung saan talaga nagtatagal? What are the really long bottlenecks na ano? Was it the land conversion application sa DAR? I couldn't read it. I don't know if it was 300 or 200 days. That's really long. Kung
anyway, I think you misread. Oh, there's no procedure which involve or no permit which involve 300 plus days. Oh. But anyway, the inception report is available at the EPDP. But the important question that you raise is if I may interpret it, is where are the bottlenecks in the process flow that we showed? Where are the bottlenecks? Well, some stakeholders here, I hope they're not so sensitive, but there are, you know, some which we may call guilty parties. For example, the National Grid Corporation. Hi, Reddy, Engineer Reddy Rimorosa. Sorry. But the grid impact study of the National Grid Corporation takes time, and many generating companies are actually complaining that the bottleneck is there. No? But there are those GenCos which are saying or insisting that the bottleneck lies at the local government level, especially if the location will affect many, or the perception is that it will affect many barangays, many municipalities. Then you have to talk with each of them. But there are also LGUs, which were initially adamant, not very cooperative, but then the GenCo decided to locate to a nearby LGU, nearby municipality, and the benefits of naturally accrued to that LGU. And when the first LGU, which was approached by the GenCo, saw that the benefits are real, then they want the next GenCo to locate in their municipality. That happened in Quezon province, actually. So there are those kinds of cases. No, the bottlenecks are in the private company, which is a major player, and the bottlenecks are in the government side. And of course, ERC, Energy Regulatory Corporation, sorry. But there are a lot of complaints about how the ERC acts on the applications at what we may call a snail-paced process. No, unfortunately, the ERC's constraint is a lack of manpower, lack of technical capacity to handle voluminous applications, to review several cases. And I think that can be partly resolved because the particular portion of the permitting process which involve ERC intervention is in the review of the power supply agreement. So I think one development that will help that concern, the bottleneck at the ERC, is the competitive supply procurement proposal.
Okay, another question from the gentleman again. Then I'll entertain one more question.
It's also about the power plant approval. And I would recommend, if you look at the permits or the things that have to be gone through, that you have three levels. One is maybe for business as a whole. No? Everybody needs a business permit. It doesn't have to be electricity. The next one is then you look at electricity as a product. And the next one you look at what is the technology. Is it solar? Is it hydro? So maybe you would look at it in this, on these three levels, and then you get different kind of flow charts. And of course, if I look at the two examples that you had with the opposition was about coal, and even Pope Francis is against coal.
Okay. Yes. The lady. Yes.
Good afternoon, I'm Jamie Maliari from FDC Utilities. You've mentioned that here in the Philippines, there's a long process in securing of permits for project development. So after identifying and evaluating all the sources of bottlenecks, what do you suggest or what are your plans or proposals in contributing in addressing such challenges?
Okay, so I think that the comments from the two gentlemen are quite related because I think we would like to emphasize too that the permitting process, the number of delays that a particular generating company faces depends on the location and also on the type of technology. And the example, the process flow that we showed during the presentation is an example of the hydro plant. So this, of course, are different. So what we're saying is that it may even be possible that one generation plant would have would face a specific different kinds of regulation and hence different kinds of permits. And also may the number of permitting process may also be unique to a particular generation company depending on location and technology. And then concerning the policy implications, of course our intended objective, that is one of the research objective. And of course, at this stage, we would also again like to emphasize that maybe it's very preliminary to come up with policy proposals. But at this stage, of course, we could already identify some redundant steps, and this may improve and facilitate and cut down the number of permits and also the period, the time it takes to construct a power plant.
All right. Yes, one more.
Hi, good afternoon. I'm Emmy Blanco from PISALM Corporation. My question is for Professor Alonso. Sir, in your study, is the assessment of the privatization policy of the government included? The reason I ask is that the national government, including PISALM and the other energy corporations, are always being asked by Congress to explain or to defend why we have to privatize the remaining NAPCOR plants, like the remaining plants in Mindanao, Agus Pulangi, and also Arcalayaan or CBK plant in Luzon. So maybe if you could include that, we could benefit, the government could benefit, and also maybe it could lead to putting safeguards or conditions in our privatization structure.
Yeah, the privatization aspect, of course, is within EPIRA itself. You know, like under EPIRA, generation has been privatized, except that yeah, in Mindanao, particularly those hydro plants in Mindanao still are in the hands of PISALM. And I suppose the apprehension of Congress stems mainly from the fact that, rates continue to be high, you know. And yeah, but at this point we have not paid particular focus yet on what the issues are on whether the assets remaining with PISALM should in fact be privatized, based on the EPIRA, or whether government should retain certain power generation facilities at this point, at least for leverage, no? In a way. No? But when we, I think, when we eventually moved to a fuller market where, as Professor Wallach was describing this morning, where we have not only spot markets, but futures markets and forward markets as well, then perhaps full privatization would in fact be called for in that situation. But I don't know, but when we will get there remains a question.
All right, I have just one more question. It's from myself, from to Professor Akma. I just want to know whether the effects of the recent conflict between Turkey and Russia, what kind of effects do they have on the risk of Turkish pursuit of an energy hub?
As you know, last November, we just has started a new position with Russia. Then in the near future, I believe that in the near future, Russia and Turkey has a going to a good relation again, because Russia needs more goods from Turkey. It should import from Turkey many goods, including fruit and vegetables and others. Then in the near future, Turkey and Russia going to good relation with each other. Even there is some problem, especially with Syria and Iran and other countries. As you know, there is a big competition, because Russia also wants to a big power in our region, not only Caspian Sea region, but also the Middle East. Then there is a big dilemma, because it's not possible to be to position both Caspian Sea and the Middle East. Then Russia should be careful, and Russia should be more concentrate of how can we improve our relation in the near future, especially in Middle East countries, and Middle East is not stable area. Then Russia doesn't have any, hasn't any experience about Middle East countries, their politics, their international relation, and their energy. Then Russia should be very careful in the near future, especially should be set up a good relation with Turkey again.
All right, thank you very much. So please give our presenters a round of applause. And there is a 2 to 3 minute coffee break. Okay, thank you. Oh, okay.